Let's take our copy of God's Word, the Bible, your iPad, iPhone, Kindle, or tablet, whatever you use to study and read God's Word, and turn with me to Luke's Gospel, chapter 2, verses 8 through 11. Now, last week I shared with you lessons that I have learned from these wise men, and today I'm going to be sharing with you lessons that I have learned from the shepherds. Now, the messages that we give at New Hope are biblical, they are positive, and they are practical. Luke chapter 2, verses 8 through 11, let's see what it says. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we bow our hearts and our prayers in your presence today, and we ask you to meet the needs of your wonderful people. You are a good God, and for all you do, we are going to give you praise, glory, and honor, for I pray with a grateful heart and a thankful heart, in the name of Jesus, amen. Folks, the title of my message today is Lessons That I Have Learned from the Shepherds. Now, folks, we don't say Happy Holidays anymore. We say Merry Christmas. And I say to you, folks, Merry Christmas. Did you hear about this guy that went out and he was looking for a tree to buy for Christmas, and he came by this establishment, and they had a sign that they were selling holiday trees. And so he approached the person in charge, and he said, I want a 4th of July holiday tree. And the guy said, well, I'm sorry, we don't sell 4th of July holiday trees. Then the guy said, well, call it what it is. A Christmas tree. And that's exactly what we are celebrating this year. Not so much Happy Holidays, but Merry Christmas. Now, in spite of the horrific pandemic crisis that we are in, I am convinced that looking at these shepherds, you and I can discover, in spite of, it is still a wonderful life. I'm going to prove that to you in my message today. Now, many years ago, when our kids were growing up in our family, we had somewhat of a tradition of watching It's a Wonderful Life. And our daughter Willow really dived into that movie. And to this day, it is still number one on her list of favorite movies to watch. And so this past week, I again watched It's a Wonderful Life. Now, I hadn't seen this movie for several years, and so this past week it was a refresher course for me, and I learned some lessons there in that movie that we can apply to our spiritual lives. Now, you know the story. It was featuring the famous actor Jimmy Stewart, which is still one of my favorite actors, and Donna Reed. And I would encourage you to carve out some time and look once again at the movie, It's a Wonderful Life. Now, it's the story of George Bailey, and it was played, as I said, by the great Jimmy Stewart. And George Bailey lived in a small town. The name of the town was Bedford Falls, just a small town, but George Bailey had aspirations to move out beyond Bedford Falls. He wanted to get a college education. He wanted to make a name for himself. He wanted to invent and build some things. And he wanted to see this vast world that he lived in. And so George Bailey wanted to get out of Bedford Falls. Howsoever, George Bailey encountered some problems. And you know, folks, problems is a common denominator of us all. Life 101, there are going to be problems in our lives, and we won't get through this life without encountering some problems. And George Bailey had several problems. One of the biggest problems that he had was a financial situation. And he reached a point where George Bailey said, you know what, life just isn't worth living anymore. And it was right at Christmas time, and so George decided that he would end his life. You know, folks, there are more suicides that take place around the Christmas season than at any other time in the year. And that's what George Bailey decided to do. He decided that he was going to go up to a bridge. He was going to jump off the bridge into the water below and drown himself. Well, he got to the bridge, and George encountered a man. His name was Clarence. Now, Clarence was actually an angel, although George didn't recognize Clarence as being an angel. He was just another individual out there. And so Clarence was actually a guardian angel. Now, folks, I don't know how you feel about guardian angels, but I believe that every one of us have at least one guardian angel. And I believe that's scriptural. Every one of us has at least one guardian angel. You say, Dale, where do you get that? Well, let's turn to the Bible. Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 2. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. Some of us have entertained angels unaware. Remember that best-selling book that Dale Evans wrote years ago, Angel Unaware? Remember that television movie back in the middle 90s, Touched by an Angel? Some of us have had angels in our presence, and we really didn't realize that it was actually an angel. Maybe some of you have had that happen in your life. And literally, George says, my life right now is nothing but a big mess. I'm just going to end my life. He said these words, it would have been better if I had never been born. Now, how many of you, how many of us, at a low point in our lives, have said those very same words? It would have been better if I had never been born. Well, Clarence said, George, listen up. That's just not true. Because let me tell you something. A lot of people's lives have been impacted by you, George. And you, what you don't realize is that had you not been there, Harry, your brother, would have drowned. Harry would have drowned. Remember? when he was drowning in the lake, and you jumped in and you rescued him and brought him to shore. And then, as a result, your ear was damaged and you lost hearing in your ear. George, you remember that day when you were working for the druggist, Mr. Gower, and he was packing poison into a prescription, and you told him so. And he rebuked you for telling him that he was putting poison in a prescription. In fact, he became quite violent with you. And you said, "Don't you understand? If you put a poison in this prescription, someone's going to die because of that. And not only that, Mr. Gower, you will be arrested and prosecuted and charged with manslaughter." And George, you remember that? And George, you remember how you impacted your father's business when he died, and you took over the business? And had you not taken over the business, the building and loan business, Henry Potter, who all people knew was the meanest man in town, and he would have taken over the town, and instead of it being Bedford Falls, he would have moved it to Pottersville. You remember that, George? I want you to know something, George. Clarence, the angel, was reminding George of. You made an impact in other people's lives. You made a difference, George, in other people's lives. And what I really like about this story, folks, is that the goal should be for every one of us to make a difference in someone else's life. Now, folks, for 33 years, we have been preaching New Hope in our church, and our goal is to work in concert with the Holy Spirit to change people's lives, to get them walking out of darkness into light. And I have story after story of people. Some have passed on and gone to heaven, whose lives were changed, altered, because of the message of New Hope. And folks, I can look back on over these years, and I'm humbled to realize how God used me, just a common man, and others at New Hope, to make an impact on people's lives. Abraham Lincoln said, "God must love common people because he made so many of them." And I like what the Bible says about Jesus. It says the common people heard and received him gladly. And so George Bailey was just an ordinary guy, but God used him. But let me tell you some other ordinary folks. These guys were not dignitaries. These guys were not educated. These guys were not elitists. Literally, these guys were mentioned 200 times in the Bible, but their testimony was not even admissible in the court of law. These guys were shepherds. But God used shepherds to make the greatest announcement that's ever been made. Think about that. God used just common, ordinary shepherds to make the greatest announcement ever made. Made it to a group of farmers, to a group of shepherds. And God used those shepherds in tremendous ways. And what I want us to do in this message, I believe we can look at these shepherds, and those shepherds can teach us some lessons how we can enjoy this wonderful life in spite of the crises that we are living under. And so I want to share with you in this message lessons that I have learned from these shepherds. Lesson number one, realize and learn that life is a gift. Realize and learn that life is a gift. The Bible says in Luke chapter 2 and verse 8, "And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. Another translation says it this way, which I kind of like. Those shepherds were camping in the neighborhood. I like that translation. How many of you have ever actually watched It's a Wonderful Life? I would really encourage you to carve out some time and watch this very, very good movie with spiritual implications. It's a Wonderful Life. And what's interesting, this movie is called It's a Wonderful Life, and it was taken from a famous book called The Greatest Gift. It was from this book, The Greatest Gift, that this movie was produced and directed. And so we've got to learn, folks, that life is a gift from God. Life is a gift from God. Look what the Bible says. I read about this young lady who was always complaining about what she didn't have. And look what the Bible says about complaining. When I complain, my spirit's going to be overwhelmed. And when you complain, your spirit is going to be just that, overwhelmed. Complaining, folks, is not going to do you a bit of good. It will just overwhelm you. And so this young lady was complaining about all the things that she didn't have. And finally her mother got tired of listening to her complain, and she had had enough of it. And so she said, "Let me tell you something, young lady. I know all the things that you don't have, but I want to remind you of what you do have. I gave you the greatest gift than anyone can give you, and that is life. I gave you life. And the greatest thing that I could ever give you was life." You want to know something, folks? Life is our gift from God. And what we do with our life is a gift back to God. Life is a gift, folks. And we need to learn that principle and remember it. Look what the Bible says in Psalm 139:14. "I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works." You say, "Dale, are you against abortion?" Folks, I want to tell you something. I'm not just against abortion, but I'm for life. I believe that all lives matter. Can you say amen to that? I believe in the intrinsic value of life. I believe every life matters. I believe that life is special. I believe that life is sacred from the womb to the tomb. God said in His Word, "Choose life that you may live." We are wonderfully and fearfully made by God. Wonderfully made by God. Folks, listen up. When you're battling a low self-esteem, if you think that somehow you're less than other people, I want you to know something. Take a look in the mirror and say, "I am wonderfully and fearfully made in the image of God." The Bible says He makes all things what? He makes all things beautiful. And you are beautiful in the eyes of God. I love the story about that little granddaughter sitting in the lap of her grandpa. And she put her hands on her cheeks and she said, "Grandpa, did God make me?" And rubbing her cheeks a little bit, grandpa said, "Honey, God did indeed make you. She thought about that for a moment, and then she looked up at Grandpa and said, "Grandpa, did God make you? And he said, "Yes, sweetheart, God made me." And then she said, "Grandpa, God's doing a better job now than He used to." Can you say amen to that? We need to learn, folks, that life is a gift. A second lesson I have learned from these shepherds is you look and discover God's blessings. You look and discover God's blessings. Look what the Bible says in verse 8. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch. Circle those two words. Keeping watch over their flock by night. They were keeping watch over the sheep. And folks, it will do us a lot of good if we keep watch. Two men in prison looked out the prison bars. One man looked down and saw mud, but the other man looked up and he saw the stars. It all has to do with where your focus is, folks. Look and discover God's blessings in your life. They are there if you look for them. Look at Psalm 68 and 19. Look what it says. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits. God daily loads us with benefits. We walk, if we look for them, we walk in the blessings of God. Every day, God loads us, not with just one, but He loads us with blessings. You know, folks, stop and think about it. Look around. Count your many blessings. Name them one by one, the songwriter says. God blesses our socks off if we will look for it. God just blesses us. God loves to bless us with His benefits, folks. He just keeps giving to us and giving to us, and we're just walking in the goodness of God. He's blessing us every day. You know, I started a new habit not long ago, and that is at the end of the day, I take out a pen and a tablet, piece of paper, and on that tablet, I think of three things that I can thank God for that happened in my life that day, and I date it. I do that every day as the day ends now. I started that not too long ago, and I began to recognize, hey, look around. God loads us with His benefits, and we are blessed by receiving the benefits of God if we will look for them. A young boy was getting bad grades in school, and he brought home his report card, and his mother looked at it, and he said, son, you can do better than that. You're not even trying. You're smarter than that. And mom was looking at his report card and saying, son, this is not sufficient. You've got to hit the books. But his sister looked at the poor grades on his report card, and she said, hey, Mom, there's a good side to this. Mom looked once again at the report card and said, honey, there is nothing good about this report card. And the boy's sister said, oh, yes, there is. At least we know that he's not cheating. Anyway, Zig Ziglar, whom I have read many of his books and commentaries, he brought his report card home one day, and he had four F's and a D. Four F's and a D. Zig Ziglar from Yazoo City, Mississippi. And his mother said, Zig, I want some explanation for your report card. Four F's and a D doesn't cut it. He said, well, Mom, it's obvious. I'm spending too much time focusing on one subject. Folks, it's all about what you choose to focus on. Now, folks, here's what I know. Opportunities come to the faithful. Opportunities come to the faithful. You say, Dale, what are you talking about? Well, let's take a look at these shepherds. Night after night, they just kept faithfully watching over their sheep. But one night, an angelic host appeared from the sky as they were watching the sheep. This was just another mundane night, ordinary night. It was a routine night, and it was boring. But on that night, the angelic host appeared, and it changed everything in the lives of these shepherds. I've shared this with you before, but I believe it with all of my heart. What I like to say to you is, do what you can with what you have, where you are, and God won't leave you where you are, and He will increase what you have. Do what you can with what you have, where you are, and God won't leave you where you are, and He'll increase what you have. Folks, opportunities come to the faithful. So, I remind you, just be faithful. Learn to be faithful. Heard a story about this husband and wife were in bed and getting ready for a night's sleep, and she leaned over to him and said, "Honey, I love you." The husband looked her in the eyes and said, "Well, honey, I love you too." And so he said that, "I would rather die than to be unfaithful to you." And she said, "Don't worry, if you are, you will." Kind of like that story. Don't worry, if you are, you will. Opportunities come to the faithful. Years ago, I was approached by a wife, and she said, "Well, Dale, you know, my husband doesn't come to church with me all the time. He's really not very faithful in attendance." And she said, "Dale, if you would just give him a job, then he would become faithful." Well, folks, that sounds good, but it runs contrary to the Bible. Look what it says in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 12. "And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who had enabled me, and He counted me faithful." Hold on, wait just a minute here. "After I was faithful, He put me into the ministry. He counted me faithful, and then He had a ministry for me." See, you don't get a ministry to make you faithful. You become faithful. Then God gives you a ministry. So lesson learned, opportunities come to the faithful. Opportunities come to the faithful. And I might add that bad opportunities, well, they come to the unfaithful. You know, there's a book about the Grinch that stole Christmas. It was written way back in, I don't know, maybe the 90s. And it was written by Dr. Seuss. And Dr. Seuss actually wrote this book in 1957. And Dr. Seuss sold 600 million copies. But listen to this. When he wrote that first book, 27 publishers said that your book is not worth reading. Nobody would be interested in that, and they turned him down. 27 publishers. Well, he sold 600 million copies, so it looks like a lot of people enjoyed reading that book. There's even a movie made out of that book, and some churches put on the play, The Grinch, that sold Christmas. Wow. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. What did he do? He just kept on writing, The Grinch That Stole Christmas. You know, folks, there's a tremendous poem called Don't Quit. Somebody said, when things go wrong, as they sometimes will, when the road you're trudging seems all uphill, when the funds are low and debts are high, and when you want to smile but you have to sigh, when care is pressing you down a bit, rest if you must, but don't you quit. Life is strange with its twists and turns, as every one of us sometimes learns, and many a failure comes about when he might have won had he stuck it out. Don't give up. Though the pace seems slow, you may miss a failure and gain a success. with another blow. Saddest are these words, "It might have been." So, don't you quit. I know it's been said, if God is in it, there will be no fear. Second lesson we can learn from the shepherds is that opportunities can indeed be fearful. Look what the Bible says. "And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were so afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people." Now look, it's pretty obvious here that God is in this thing. Look what the Bible says. They were so afraid. Let me tell you something, folks. When God lays something upon your heart that He wants you to do, there will be some fear in it. Sometimes God wants you to do something new. He wants you to push out of your comfort zone and try something new. And when that happens, guaranteed, there will be some fear. Sometimes it'll be a new ministry, new opportunities, change. Whenever there's a change involved, there will be some fear. Take it from me, that is true. But folks, you go on in spite of your fear if you know that God is leading you. Folks, there will be some fear. And when that happens, just learn to lean on God. Now here's what I've learned over the years, folks. It's dependency upon God that brings the Holy Spirit into our lives when we are faced with a new challenge. When we are faced with a new challenge, it brings a deeper dependency upon God and on the Holy Spirit. See, from these shepherds, folks, we learn some things. Let me tell you the third thing I've learned from these shepherds, and this is live fully committed. Live fully committed. Adrian Rogers, who I think is one of the greatest preachers of all time, in our culture anyway, I love to listen to Adrian Rogers. He's my role model for expository preaching. He's one of the greatest expository preachers of our time. I have many of his sermons on DVD and CDs and cassettes. And Adrian Rogers said this, "There are two words, just two words that will change your life. Yes, Lord." Those two words will change your life if you choose to live a life that is fully committed. Yes, Lord. There's a praise song we sometimes sing in our praise and worship time. I'll say, "Yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your ways." When we sing it, do we just mouth the words? Or do we really mean it when we sing it? "Yes, Lord, yes, to your will and to your way." You know how we ought to live our lives? Fully committed. God, whatever you want, there is no debate here. The answer is, "Yes, Lord, yes." Sometimes someone will ask me, "Dale, well, what do you think about this?" And my response is, it doesn't matter what I think about it. What does God think about it? In His Word, "Yes, Lord, yes." Learn to live a fully committed life. I love the illustration of the pig and the chicken. They were out in the barnyard one day and they were having a conversation. And the chicken said, "You know what? I think that we should prepare a breakfast for our owner. Show him our appreciation for taking care of us and feeding us." And the chicken said, "Let's make ham and eggs for the owner." Pig said, "I don't know about that." Chicken said, "Oh yes." The chicken said, "I will bring the eggs and you furnish the ham." And the pig said, I don't know about that, because you're just making a contribution, chicken, but I am making a total commitment. I like that illustration. Look at Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Folks, when you live your life fully committed with a yes, Lord, yes, God, I guarantee you, will show you what he wants to do with your life. God is going to show you what he wants to do with your life when you live a fully committed life. Say, yes, Lord, yes. Folks, I want to tell you something. There is no way, absolutely no way, that our Heavenly Father wants to keep you and me in the dark. No way. There is no way you can convince me of that. God is going to make it crystal clear. And let me tell you something. The greater the change in your life, the greater the sign. It's true. The greater the sign, it's because of the greatness of change in your life. You say, Dale, where do you get all this stuff? I said, well, I get it in the Bible. My goal is to teach our people to know your Bible. Read it, study it, memorize it, meditate upon it. Look what God did in the Bible. There was a bush that didn't burn when he gave the Ten Commandments. Remember that? Think about that. When they announced the birth of Jesus, we've got signs everywhere. Angels, stars, the crucifixion, the resurrection. The greater the change in your life, the greater the signs will be there. You get fully committed, folks, and you need to be clear. You live for an audience of one, fully committed, and your attitude is, yes, Lord, yes. And you won't stay in the dark very long. Guaranteed, you won't stay very long in the dark. Look at this verse, chapter 2 of Luke, verses 11 and 12. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Now let's not just read over that. Let's study these two verses and let's process it. Who was he born for? Everyone. When was he born? This day. Where was he born? Bethlehem. Why was he born? We need a Savior. Who was he? Christ the Lord. Which baby was he? The one lying in a manger. See, God is pretty direct. When we become fully committed to him, and when we say, yes, Lord, yes. Now, let me conclude my message by going back to George Bailey. I believe that George Bailey was a yes, Lord kind of a guy, because here's George Bailey. He was getting ready to go on his honeymoon and they had a bank collapse. And he said, here, people need money. He said, here's $2,000 and it will help the people. Now think about it. When that brother fell into the water, George jumped in and saved him. Think about this. When George goes to the bridge and he was ready to end his life, he gets ready to jump. And Clarence, the guardian angel, shows up. And Clarence jumps into the water. And George, he jumps in to rescue Clarence, and George gets wet. Now, why did he get wet? Because he was rescuing Clarence. He jumps into the water to save Clarence, the angel. I think what would help a lot of us folks if we would just quit dipping our toes into the water and jump in fully committed to God. Oh, are we going to be church? Going to be going to church today? Well, I don't know. I've got some other things that I just need to get done. And Adele, I won't be in church Sunday because I've got to do some things. Let me say my response to that, bozo, listen up. It's not your day. It's the Lord's day. Hunt Bambi on Saturday. Go to church on Sunday. That's my philosophy. When someone wants you to do something when it's church time, you just simply tell them, after church, I'll be glad to go with you on whatever that may be. You say, Dale, you're talking to me. Well, I tell you what, if your phone is ringing, pick it up. Pick it up. Look what the Bible says. John said, I was in the Spirit on what day? On the Lord's day. He wasn't out on the golf course, or he wasn't at the lake. He was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. You know what? I believe some Christians are really miserable today because they are not fully committed to God. I believe that. They are trying to play both worlds, and they are miserable. In my opinion, the most miserable person on earth is the person who is trying to play both worlds. And folks, that just doesn't work. The only way that you can be fully fulfilled is to become totally committed, sold out to God with an attitude of yes, Lord, yes. Yes, Lord, yes. There's a fourth and final thing I want to draw your attention to. The fourth lesson I learned from these shepherds is lift up your praise to God. Lift up your praise to God. I thought about this verse in verse 20. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. My focus this past week has been upon these shepherds. And I looked and studied the scripture pertaining to these shepherds who were watching their flock by night when that angelic host appeared. And so I saw some things that I had never seen before, to tell you the truth. Why did these guys get so happy when they returned from the scene of Joseph and Mary and the baby? They returned, the Bible says, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen as it was told unto them. So I asked the why question, which I do a lot when I study the Bible. Why were they so happy, glorifying, and praising God? What made them so jubilant when they returned to the sheepfold? Well, I saw something that I had never seen before, and I want to share it with you. What did the shepherds do? They took care of the sheep. What happened with the sheep? They were sacrificed at the temple. Research says on certain days, there was as many as 1 million sheep killed. Research tells us on certain days, the blood was up to the knees of the priest, and it all was making a covering for the next year. That's all that it was doing. Just making a temporary covering for the people's sins for the next year. And here's why I think these shepherds were so jubilant, rejoicing and glorifying God. You know what I think they were saying to one another as they returned to the sheepfold? Fellas, guess what? I think our work is just about over. Our work is just about over because, behold, the scripture says, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world. And folks, you know what we've got to do? We've got to just lift up and praise Jesus. The Lamb of God has come that takes away the sins of the world. So folks, let me remind you that in spite of whatever difficulty you may be experiencing this Christmas season, you can enjoy a wonderful life if we buy into the lessons that we can learn from these shepherds. Number one, learn that life is a gift. Number two, look for the blessings that God loads you with daily. Number three, live a life fully committed to God. Not just half-baked, not just lukewarm, but surrender your life fully, completely to God and have the attitude, I'm living for an audience of one, and yes, Lord, yes. Whatever you say, I will do. And if you lift up your praise to God, you will experience that wonderful, wonderful life.